Hi, I'm Mary Sue Rominger. I'm on the board of directors and a volunteer for the Bateman Horne Center. Welcome, and thank you so much for being here. We will be posting a video of tonight's presentation on our YouTube channel and within the next few days. Our speaker tonight is Pelle. Grew up in Salt Lake City, but completed his undergraduate degree at Pomona College in Southern California, where he studied biology and German. He began his involvement with the Bateman Horne Center as a pre-medical student, shadowing Dr. Bateman when he would come back home in Utah for a visit. Fascinated by the stories he heard from patients and the unique medical care provided by Bateman Horne Center, he began volunteering. As a volunteer, he reviewed patient charts for research on diagnostic criteria and had the chance to carry out new patient intake interviews. After graduating from college a year ago, he returned to the Bateman Horne Center Research Department, where he has focused his energies on orthostatic intolerance, which he will be discussing tonight. He's headed to medical school in San Diego this August, so congratulations for that. Please welcome Pelle Wall.
All right. Well, thanks for coming out, everyone, and to the everyone tuning in from home. It's good to be able to present. So today I'm going to be talking about orthostatic intolerance, like Mary Sue mentioned, and specifically the 10-minute NASA-Lean test, which we've been kind of incorporating more and more here at the Bateman Horne Center. So kind of a brief overview of the presentation that I'm going to give tonight. So first I'll talk a little bit about orthostatic intolerance, or you'll hear me refer to it as OI, in ME/CFS, and I know there are some members of the audience tonight that may not know what that is. So the ME is myalgic encephalomyelitis, and CFS is chronic fatigue syndrome. People will argue if they're interchangeable or not for all intents and purposes, and tonight I'll say ME/CFS as the one illness. And then I will talk about kind of traditional orthostatic intolerance testing and autonomic testing, since they go hand in hand. And then I'll kind of dive into the actual 10-minute NASA-Lean test and some preliminary clinic data that I reviewed back in October for a poster conference, and then get into the orthostatic testing study, which is what we're doing right now. So orthostatic intolerance, kind of by definition, is the development of symptoms that, while upright, that are relieved by recumbency. So they get better when you lie down. There's a whole slew of symptoms. They manifest very differently in different people. I've got a select list here. It's not all-inclusive, but lightheadedness, fatigue, nausea, cognitive impairment, fainting, weakness, sweating, temperature intolerance. There's a whole range of symptoms that can arise from orthostatic intolerance. and they kind of fall into two categories. One is autonomic, which I'll discuss a little bit later, and the other is central nervous system mediated. So there's kind of two categories of the symptoms, but they can look different in different people or patients. The last thing is OI is often comorbid with ME/CFS, which means they occur together. And it was actually recommended as one of five core clinical diagnostic criteria by the Institutes of Medicine back in 2015. And Dr. Bateman actually sits on that committee, I believe. So kind of a general overview of orthostatic intolerance, just to understand what's happening. So being upright, like sitting or even standing more so, is a stressor in the sense that it takes the body away from equilibrium. So when you're laying down, you can imagine, I don't know if that's showing up at all, this person on the left, they have a pretty even distribution of blood flow throughout the body. Their brain has adequate perfusion. Everything's pretty even. And then as soon as you tip someone upright, they stand up. Now you're fighting against gravity, right? So all your blood wants to pull down, pulls down into your lower extremities and lower abdomen. And so your body has to find a way to basically bring it back up. And then in this diagram here, you can also see kind of the smaller red blob by the head, indicating reduced cerebral perfusion, which is going to lead to some of the central nervous system symptoms that I mentioned earlier. So of course, when you stand up, most people have compensatory mechanisms that happen. Your heart rate increases, your heart beats a little bit stronger, so your stroke volume, basically the amount of blood that you're expelling from the heart each time it contracts, increases. Blood vessels will constrict, especially in like your lower extremities, your legs, in your kind of lower abdomen area. They'll constrict and just help bring blood back up to where it's supposed to be so that everything can work properly. In orthostatic intolerance, there can be problems with the mechanisms, of course. And so that's what I'll be getting into. So orthostatic intolerance, I should mention, is kind of an umbrella term, so it captures a whole range of syndromes. There's initial orthostatic intolerance, which I imagine everyone in this room has probably experienced at some point in their life. It's basically when you stand up too quick and you kind of get like a blurred out vision or get lightheaded. That would be initial orthostatic intolerance. But most people recover from that. It's nothing super severe or chronic. But it is under the OI umbrella. And then there's a pretty well-known one, postural tachycardia syndrome, or POTS, which has to do with a exaggerated heart rate response when you stand up. And there's even subcategories of that, so different causes, neuropathic or hyperadrenergic, causes for that elevated or inappropriate heart rate response. Another big one is orthostatic hypotension. So hypotension is low blood pressure as opposed to hypertension, which you hear a lot about, high blood pressure. So basically your blood pressure is not compensating for you being upright, and then you're not getting enough perfusion to the brain, and that can lead to a variety of symptoms. So again, subclasses of OH, orthostatic hypotension. Another one, postural vasovagal syncope. So just the idea is that there's all OI is not the same. So there's lots of different subcategories. Other thing to mention is OI is often a subclass of autonomic dysfunction. So for those of you unfamiliar with the nervous system, it's kind of broken into, you know, a variety of branches. On the right, you'll see central nervous system with the brain and spinal cord. And then the left, peripheral nervous system, is everything else. And then you've got, of course, muscles that you can control voluntarily, like your skeletal muscle. You know, I can choose to lift up my arm. And then there's a whole bunch of nerves that you can't control. You're not thinking about, you know, I can't say, oh, blood vessel constrict here, and it'll do it, right? So there's lots that goes on without you thinking about consciously, and that is all comprises the autonomic nervous system. And then that's even further broken down into parasympathetic and sympathetic nervous system. You know, rest, digest, fight or flight, the kind of opposites, but all under autonomic nervous system. So the traditional means of testing orthostatic intolerance, or for a long time considered kind of the gold standard, is head up tilt table testing. Basically what they do is they strap you into a bed and have you lay supine for a period of time. That lets your body kind of calm down, you reach more fluid equilibrium, and they'll take your blood pressure and heart rate. Sometimes they do continuous monitoring, and then they'll tilt you up to about 70 degrees, have you strapped in so you don't fall, and then same thing, measure blood pressure and heart rate for a period of time. And so that's been the kind of traditional method of diagnosing or looking for orthostatic intolerance. The problems are it's pretty expensive, so it's usually done by autonomic specialists, and it's difficult to schedule. I remember Dr. Bateman was telling me about that the other day. It's difficult to find neurologists that will have the time or the ability to do it, and with that tilt table, it requires specialized equipment. They often use continuous blood pressure monitoring, which, as we found out, are pretty pricey. So basically, we need something that's affordable, that's reliable, and accessible, right? Accessible to the masses if we want to address this issue in ME/CFS patients all over. So enter the NASA 10-minute lean test. If I'm not mistaken, it was introduced to Dr. Bateman and the Bateman Horne Center by Dr. Benjamin Nadelson over in New York through the CDC, maybe. And it's a derivative of an orthostatic intolerance test developed by NASA researchers. So the reason NASA got involved is oftentimes when astronauts return from microgravity, they have all kinds of orthostatic symptoms. Their body is basically deconditioned. It's not used to fighting gravity anymore. And so it kind of gets lazy. And then you get a lot of orthostatic intolerance in them. So what we use in the clinic and in research is kind of a derivative of that. So we've kept the name NASA. it's similar to head-up tilt, but it doesn't really require any specialized equipment other than some way to measure blood pressure and heart rate. So kind of the gist of it is you rest supine, so same thing, you're flat on a table for 10 to 15 minutes. That lets your autonomic nervous system calm down, and you start to reach more fluid equilibrium that maybe you had some pooling from standing up for a long period of time. That'll kind of balance out. And then we move to a passive stand. Here's a picture of me. And you can actually see, so my feet are about 6 inches, my heels are about 6 inches from the wall, and then just the top of my shoulders are touching the wall. My bum's away from the wall, and so I'm kind of leaning on the wall for support. But what that does is it allows your leg muscles, skeletal muscles to relax, whereas if I'm standing actively, this is an active stand, leaning against the wall would be a passive stand, and that reduces the skeletal muscle influences on venous return. So it's basically one of the methods that you have to bring blood back up to the rest of the body. But if you're trying to test for any autonomic dysfunction, if you introduce the skeletal muscle influence of your legs contracting, that can kind of make results a little bit wonky and difficult to interpret. So hence the passive stand. And then once upright in this position, we take blood pressure and heart rate every minute for 10 minutes total. And then we also like to record comments, you know, especially symptoms. I'm feeling lightheaded, my legs feel hot, you know, whatever it might be, we like to record those as well. So we started doing it more in the clinic, and Dr. Bateman started to see some pretty interesting results. So she asked me to do a more systematic review of the lean test that we had done in the clinic. Basically wanted to see, you know, what is there? Do we have anything here? Are there potentially subgroups that are starting to emerge a little bit, and basically use it as a springboard for future research in this area? So these are the results. Select results, actually pulled these off of a poster that's hanging in our research hallway if anyone cares to look at that at any point. But basically, I analyzed the maximal changes from supine, so resting horizontal in heart rate and blood pressure, to the most different heart rate or blood pressure during the 10-minute stand portion. So I've got that left chart shows all 41 patients that I analyzed. So each dot represents just the maximum change. It's not saying that all the standing heart rate or blood pressure measurements were that extreme, but that's the most different. And so the left is systolic blood pressure. That left column on the left chart is systolic blood pressure, which is the pressure in your arteries when your heart's actively contracting. And then one column over, DBP, diastolic blood pressure, is the pressure in your arteries when your heart is not actively contracting, so in between beats. And so there seems to be a trend of, it's not true for everyone, but a trend of systolic blood pressure dropping. So those horizontal lines on each column are representing the average. So it tends to be dropping, and then diastolic blood pressure tends to be increasing. So you get this what's called narrowing of pulse pressure. It's not true for everyone, but that was another trend we saw. And pulse pressure is just the difference between diastolic and systolic. So the little colored boxes I have there are representing your meeting criteria for orthostatic hypotension. So a pretty substantial proportion of the patients that we reviewed were meeting criteria for orthostatic hypertension and their systolic and or diastolic pressures. And then that right column is heart rate. So elevated heart rate responses almost invariably, with one exception. And the top box will have they meet criteria for POTS, the postural tachycardia syndrome. This right chart, I don't want to get too much into it, but it's basically a frequency of these changes, of maximal blood pressure and heart rate changes. And you can see that it's not an insignificant portion of our patients that we did nasaline tests on that are displaying or meeting criteria. They're kind of meeting the threshold for what we'd consider abnormal. So the vast majority, 3/4 of the tested patients met criteria for abnormal blood pressure and or heart rate changes. So in one category or the other, withstanding. And so we thought it's definitely merits some further research. Seems to be an issue, but you know there's more to look into. So some of the limitations of this were there was inconsistent test preparations for the reviews or the nasaline tests that were done in the clinic. I think we're getting much better as we go on and learn more, but you know, people were on different medications that may or may not influence blood pressure and heart rate. They're using different compensatory behaviors, so if they're fluid loading or salt loading ahead of time, that can artificially increase their blood pressure, and that can affect the results of the nasaline tests. We didn't know if they were fasted, if they'd just eaten, and that's something that can influence it as well. And the last thing is there were no controls. So it's been really difficult to find any sort of literature about what is a healthy person's blood pressure and heart rate doing when they move from a from a supine to a standing position. I would have thought there'd be more, but it's been difficult to find. So it could be that these kinds of abnormal or what we're considering abnormal responses are present in healthy controls as well. So the orthostatic testing study, as we've called it, is our current research. So it's what we're doing right now. I spent some months getting the protocol ready. We got IRB approval, so ethics board approval. We actually just got funded for some of it, which is great. So this is our current study that we're working on right now. So the broad goals of it are kind of to measure the lean test's usefulness in a number of areas. So can it be used to recognize and diagnose orthostatic intolerance or different subgroups of OI? Can it be used to effectively inform and direct treatment for OI syndromes? So one of the nice things about the test is because orthostatic intolerance is so broad, you may get certain symptoms that are caused by very different physiological changes, right? And so if we can use the lean test to kind of narrow it down a little bit, you know, is this an issue with a blood pressure drop? Is it a narrow pulse pressure? Is it a heart rate response that we're trying to target? That lets us direct drugs or direct treatments that instead of just kind of randomly guessing and throwing meds or behavioral changes to the patient, it allows us to kind of hone in a little bit on what we should do. Also, potentially a good tool for primary care physicians to recognize and treat ME/CFS. I know that's something that's been very difficult. Primary care physicians don't feel like they have any tools or nothing standardized to recognize ME/CFS or treat the illness. And we also just want to use the study to learn more about orthostatic intolerance in general in our patient population. And the effect on cognitive performance in the patients that's associated or may be associated with being upright. So there's the possibility that we get a new objective measure for ME/CFS. Can't say that for sure, but it may help, which is pretty exciting. So kind of an overview of what we're doing in this study. We're basically tracking changes. Same with normal orthostatic testing, tracking changes moving from supine to standing position. So the main ones are hemodynamic, which is heart rate and blood pressure. And we're also tracking cognitive changes, in particular reaction time and processing speed. And then we've got some fancy SIM bands, which are, actually got one in front of me, kind of fancy Apple watches from Samsung that have a variety of sensors on the inside. This one actually has an EKG lead that we can hook up to the chest. And so we get EKG data, we get GSR, which is a galvanic skin response. It's basically a measure of sympathetic nervous activation. So that was one of the subclasses of the autonomic nervous system, skin temperature, and there's a variety of others, but those are kind of the three major ones we want to pull from the SIMBAND data. And then we're also doing it in ME/CFS patients and healthy controls. And I stressed earlier the importance of having healthy controls because there really is a paucity in the literature of what is normal, right? What do normal individuals, what do their responses look like when they move from supine to standing or in this passive stand position? So test prep, because that was inconsistent in our earlier, the review that I did, we really wanted to make sure everything was as similar as possible between subjects. So we have them stop salt and fluid loading. So salt helps your body retain water. Fluid, of course, is adding more volume to your blood. So we have them stop that for 48 hours before testing. And then wash out of relevant medications. So there's a whole bunch of different medications that can affect blood pressure. And so we have Dr. Bateman review the medication list that they're on and then kind of tailor a plan for that patient to either wash out completely or at least reduce certain medications that might affect the results of the lean test. In line with the medications, no alcohol, nicotine, or caffeine for 24 hours prior. Same thing, because they can have an effect on blood pressure and heart rate. And then no compression clothing during testing. And compression clothing, I mean, it acts the same way as skeletal muscles. So if you're wearing compression tights, then kind of squeeze your leg and help bring your blood up to the upper part of your body, up to your brain, which, of course, we want to see if you're having trouble with that. So this is an overview of a testing visit. So this is the visit when we have them do some questionnaires beforehand, and then they come in for a one-time testing visit. Ask a brief question, you know, how are you doing, just to kind of establish baseline. And then 5 minutes supine on an exam table. So it's the same thing with the normal NASA lean test. Bring everything down, calm the autonomic nervous system, start to establish fluid equilibrium. And then we have them sit up with their feet still elevated to do their first cognitive test, and that's to establish baseline cognitive performance on reaction time and processing speed, then lay back down, and now we're starting to get into just our standard NASA lean test, 10-minute supine with two blood pressure and heart rate readings at the end of that, and then standing for the 10-minute orthostatic challenge with their, you know, the heel 6 inches from the wall, upper back touching, and staying as still as possible. And then we do, as soon as they're finished with that orthostatic challenge, they sit back down, and then we administer the exact same cognitive test. And the cognitive test is on this little tablet. It's like it's kind of like an iPad with little brain games that you do. So the exact same cognitive test the second time. So in terms of cognitive performance, we're basically comparing within each subject the first cognitive test versus the second. So our hypotheses, as we don't have really any data yet, we're expecting a greater frequency and severity of orthostatic intolerance in the ME/CFS population. That being said, it's likely and almost for sure that we'll find some sort of orthostatic intolerance in healthy controls as well as patients. So it's really a matter of frequency and severity that we're looking at. We also expect reduced cognitive performance after the standing portion in ME/CFS patients. And so the reason for that is, I guess, the going hypothesis, or the one that I'm most aware of, is you get reduced cerebral perfusion. So your body can't get blood back up from your lower extremities, so it's not getting enough blood to the brain. And then, of course, it doesn't work as well. So we would expect an association between abnormal blood pressure and heart rate and the post-standing, so the cognitive test done immediately after their standing portion, as they may have a reduced blood flow to their brain at that point. But again, we got to wait for the results. So in conclusion, I don't think that the nasaline test is some magic bullet that it's going to be able to single-handedly diagnose ME-CFS, but it's definitely an important piece of the puzzle. And one of the things that I think I learned for the first time coming to the Bateman Horne Center and watching Dr. Bateman practice is you can have a profound influence on people's lives, not curing the illness entirely, but just focusing on little pieces, making small steps forward, making progress in lots of little areas, and that can drastically improve someone's quality of life. And so for me, medical care, I think I realize, is bigger than just curing an illness. You know, it doesn't require some bullet, I'm going to give you a drug, and now we're totally cured of illness. You know, medical care is a lot bigger than that. And in terms of, you know, my involvement with the nasaline test and orthostatic intolerance, I realize this is just kind of a small piece of ME-CFS, of the illness itself. But it's definitely worth spending time on if it can drastically improve people's quality of life. So with that, I can take any questions.
The time between sitting patients back up again after they've been in the supine, in the standing position, to do the exercises, the cognitive testing.
The second.
What time are you using? 1 minute.
The second cognitive test.
Or first and second, either.
Oh, so in the second cognitive test, they're going immediately from the standing position, sit down, and then we hand them the tablet, and then that takes about 5 minutes for the whole thing, but it's immediately after.
Okay.
Yeah.
And the same with the first one.
The first one, they're going from laying down, sitting up. As soon as they sit up, we hand them the tablet, and they, yeah.
Okay, do we have any other questions? So we have some questions on our Facebook audience, but Dr. Suzanne Vernon has been online answering those questions, so
good.
She's doing a good job.
Better than me, I'm sure.
Helping you out there.
Yeah.
So are there any other questions here in the room?
I don't know if you want to venture into this, but I thought it might be interesting for you to report some of what you've observed when you're doing the study.
So there's no definitive results. It's all anecdotal, I guess, at this point. We've definitely had some very interesting abnormal blood pressure, heart rate changes. What I think is most interesting is that we've actually had some pretty extreme cases with healthy controls. So just this morning, we had a subject come in who ended up fainting at 10 minutes. A healthy woman ended up fainting at 10 minutes. So it's going to be interesting, I think, to look at the data and see if we can actually use the test to parse out ill patients or patients with orthostatic symptoms in their life and healthy patients. I think I mentioned earlier, one of the big trends we see is this narrowing of pulse pressure. So the diastolic blood pressure, the bottom number elevates, comes up, and then the systolic tends to drop or stay steady. That being said, there's lots of different subgroups, I think, and it'll be really interesting to kind of pull those out a little bit more.
Are you excluding patients with valvular disease or any other heart conditions, even mild heart failure?
So we do ask one of our something that's exclusionary to participate in the study is heart failure, is previous heart failure in the last 5 years. I've not asked specifically, but something that we could look into, make sure.
Aortic stenosis,
yeah.
Mitral regurg, they're all things
that can affect,
have a major impact.
Yeah.
Can have a major impact.
Can you say a little bit about the difference between pump failure and circulatory failure in terms of what we think is happening with patients? I'm sorry, putting you on the spot.
Yeah, I'm not sure I'm in the best position to answer that, but so there can be a pump failure. So the heart is a big pump, right? It pumps blood through the whole body. and so we don't think that this is a problem with the pump itself. So it's not like a weak heart or some problem with the heart itself. We believe that it's more peripheral, or at least a lot of the time more peripheral, so that there's a problem with vasoconstriction, constricting the blood vessels to help blood return to the heart. So for instance, with POTS, a lot of the time, which is the elevated heart rate response, at least some of the time it looks like your heart starts pumping too much, it's getting signals, pump, 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 and it's going so fast that it actually can't, you're not getting enough blood in the chamber, so preload to adequately pump it out. So it's basically pumping too fast, you're not getting enough blood, and then your blood pressure's dropping because you're getting kind of mixed signals. And so that's something that you can treat with like a beta blocker, I believe. You can slow down the heart, let it fill up each time before it contracts and ejects blood into the bloodstream, or into the circulatory system. But most of the time, at least for these patients, we believe it's more peripheral problems, not a problem with the heart or the pump itself. I think there's a question back there.
Are you looking for subjects? And if so, what would someone do who might be interested in that?
We are definitely looking for subjects. So we have a screener, but you could talk to me after. That'd be great.
Okay, so we have another comment here. They're asking you, Pelle, to describe the cognitive testing a bit more, please.
Yeah, so it's basically three, we call them brain games. So the first one is a very simple, a bullseye pops up on your screen and you touch it to go away. So very simple reaction time, bullseye comes up, touch the screen. The second one is so there's four numbers that pop up, either a two, a three, a four, or a five. And there's one button that says two or three, another button that says four or five. So you have to recognize the number that comes up and then make the decision, is that a two or three or a four or five? So that's more of like a processing. You have to process, it's not a simple reaction to something that, a stimulus that pops up on the screen. The third one is it's called go, no go. So there's a building with six different windows and an alien pops up. So it's either green or gray. If it's gray, you blast the alien. If it's green, you just stay and don't do anything. So they're kind of fun little brain games, but they're really geared towards processing speed and reaction time.
And those cognitive tests are not identical, is that correct?
The cognitive tests, the first one and the second?
Yeah.
They are exactly identical. Yeah.
We
don't think so. That's one of the things I asked the person we're coordinating with at Dana, is that they're simple enough, and we have a practice section before each one, so they don't think that you're going to get better at it over time. It's simple enough that you should be kind of up to speed after your initial practice section, so it's not like your second test you're going to be better because you've taken it again. Yeah.
The question is, do you believe that wearing compression stockings would help with symptoms of OI?
I'm sure it depends on what kind of subcategory of orthostatic intolerance you have, but I know a lot of the time it definitely can. It just helps with venous return, right? So it helps squeeze your legs and help blood just get back up to your upper body and to your brain. So I've heard very good things about it. I'm sure it's not a magic bullet, as nothing tends to be, but... yes.
Okay. Any other questions? All right. Let me just check one last time here on Facebook. Okay. Okay. I have no more questions, so.
There is one more.
Oh, you said, okay.
Will Dr. Bateman have all the patients do the test at some point?
Will Dr. Bateman have... all the patients do the test sometime?
Yes, we're trying to do the test more and more often in the clinic so that we understand where it might be useful. And usually we can use it in two settings. One is try to take people off the medicines and the compensation and see if we can look at the primary issue going on with orthostatic intolerance. But the other is we've been using it to assess treatment. So once we start doing interventions, you could do the lean test at any time to assess the current regimen and see if it makes an improvement over what it looked like before. And I was just going to say that you know, even if we don't see that there is a specific type of orthostatic intolerance that's different than normal controls, what we're doing is looking for a treatment target in patients who are otherwise compromised. And so it'll be interesting to see how it pans out. But I can, and Pelle hasn't been involved in any treatment aspects, but I can tell you that what I've learned from using the NASA lean test is how to do more directed treatment interventions. And sometimes our treatment is a wrong choice, like giving people beta blocker who immediately who start with a very low blood pressure and whose primary issue is a drop in blood pressure. And sometimes they don't even have an adequate heart rate response for what's happening. You just devastate those people putting them on a beta blocker. So you can't just follow the paradigm of some of the recommended drugs without having some data to look at. We're doing a little bit of experimentation, but you know, it still goes back basically to increasing volume, and which is basically filling the tank, or adding constriction, which is making the tank smaller. And then you can do a few other kinds of interventions, but it's been very, very helpful, and I think everybody who has ME/CFS and fibro, actually, if you're functionally impaired, if you have a hard time standing in place or doing activities upright, then I think it would be very useful. Last thing I wanted to say is, if we learn that ME/CFS is more a primary defect of the cells, and the cells in your body's inability to make enough energy, it's possible that a little bit of orthostatic intolerance causes a lot more problems in people with ME/CFS than it would in a healthy person. So I think we should, you know, continue looking at the science and be open-minded and see what we can learn.
Okay, another question. How does energy production in the cell impact this?
I don't know if I can answer that directly, but I know. So basically, one of the main things that blood does is transport oxygen, right? That's what your red blood cells are primarily there to do. So if you're not getting enough blood flow to an area, you can't really bring as much oxygen. And so maybe it's a little bit too much in depth, but oxygen is your terminal electron acceptor. So you can make a tiny, tiny bit of energy anaerobically, so in the absence of oxygen, but you make, I don't know, 15 times more when you do have oxygen present. So if you're already energy depleted, if there is some sort of issue with the mitochondria, or an issue with producing energy in the cell, if you suddenly starve it of oxygen even more, that may just exacerbate the problem.
And the delivery of glucose.
And true, very true. And delivery of energy, right? Right.
I just wonder, Dr. Bateman, are you the only practice that you know of that's using the NASA lean test to for the orthostatic intolerance?
We're trying to pioneer this particular version of orthostatic testing in a way that will label it and make it accessible to physicians out there who don't specialize in this illness. But I would say that most ME/CFS clinicians do orthostatic testing. And the Institute of Medicine report that came out in 2015 with the clinical diagnostic criteria has a very good description of doing a lean test, a 10-minute lean test. So this has been around a long time, and we think it's a very underutilized tool. And I think it's more underutilized here in the U.S., and there are a lot of areas and pockets where it's where the orthostatic intolerance issues are very recognized and routinely addressed.
Another Facebook question. First of all, you got to thank you.
Oh.
Can symptoms of OI just be difficulty standing or feeling much better when supine, or is it always accompanied by heart rate and blood pressure problems?
I don't know if it's always accompanied by blood pressure, heart rate problems. It by definition is looking at symptoms. So orthostatic is literally being upright, and intolerance, you're intolerant to being upright. So if there are symptoms that present when you move from a lying or sitting position to an upright position and then get better when you lay back down, I think I would call that orthostatic intolerance, even if there wasn't an associated blood pressure or heart rate drop or change that you noticed.
Okay, another question. How was it modified from the original NASA test?
you know, I don't know the whole history.
There were lots of tests.
Yeah. Okay.
Okay. So.
I would say there was a series of publications and tests. There wasn't just one test called the Nassalene test. But what's important is they actually, back in, at, you know, decades ago, there were papers published saying that this type of testing was as useful as formal tilt table testing. And there have been some more recent, there has been at least one recent paper. So that's what we're trying to ask, especially in this population, is this something that can substitute for tilt table testing, which is the gold standard, simply because it's not that accessible to all patients and to all clinicians.
Okay, any last questions or comments? All right, and I don't see any others from Facebook, so I guess that's a wrap. Thank you so much, folks.
Thank you.
Awesome.